Readings. The following presentation from James Tyberonn is based on Metatronic and Edgar Cayce Readings and will begin after this introduction. The specific focus of James's presentation is on the subject of what is termed the Forbidden Stone of Mastery, crystalline translucent azurite. This very rare crystalline form of the azurite mineral was only used by advanced initiated graduates of the ancient mystery schools for ceremony, visioning, astral travel, and for direct communication with God Source. James's fascinating video presentation will begin, as mentioned, after this brief introduction, and was filmed before a live audience of over 500 attendees at the Earthkeeper Crystal Stargate event in late November of 2015 in the Sacred Crystal Vortex of Arkansas. Again, we are speaking of a rare form of azurite, specifically the crystalline form of azurite, which was termed by Edgar Cayce as Lapis Linguis. Azurite is considered a very sacred stone, and is used, per Cayce and Metatronic, to connect to higher realms, and speak with the divine in a rare, extremely clear, interface. In the ancient Atlantean, Lemurian, Greek and Egyptian traditions, it was a stone of such revered status, that its use was restricted, and was only allowed for ceremonial use by certain initiates and highly advanced master shaman and savants who were capable of navigating crystalline azurite's intense vibrational capacity. Edgar Cayce called it lapis linguis, and strongly recommended it for psychic development, and advised wearing it next to the skin as pendant in its natural form, or holding it in the hand for best visioning results. Cayce also suggested that azurite could be activated by sunlight, and when charged in sunlight, azurite projected an audible vibrational tone, which he called the singing effect, and that tone opened the chakras, opened and stimulated the thyroid and pineal glands for audio channeling and astral travel. Cayce also stated that a light sprinkling of water on the crystalline form of true untreated natural azurite can also induce the tonal singing effect for audio telepathy. The rare crystalline deposits and natural crystalline specimens of azurite are capable of enhancing both astral travel and teleportation if the user is of advanced psychic development and sufficient light quotient mastery. Ancient Greeks used azurite in healing and mystical ceremonies. Ancient Greek and Egyptian legend say that azurite was one of the most sacred and powerful healing stones used by the Atlara, the spiritual scientist priests of Atlantis, where its psychic amplification powers were so effectual and so powerfully potent that only the capable graduate masters of the mystery schools, only the advanced highly initiates, were given access to crystalline azurite. Because its vibrations were too strong for the uninitiated, too powerful for the untrained, and thus it became shrouded in mystery, restricted from the untrained, uninitiated masses, and became known as the Forbidden Stone of Mastery. Now, let us speak of Edgar Cayce's extraordinary experience with this remarkable gemstone. And let us be clear, we are speaking of natural crystalline azurite, and not all azurite is crystalline. In fact, the crystalline form of azurite is extremely rare, extremely rare. Edgar Cayce's missing month. In 1934, Edgar Cayce faced his greatest trials. He was arrested for practicing medicine without a license, and his primary financial backer went bankrupt, forcing the closure of the Edgar Cayce Hospital and the Cayce Foundation's Atlantic University. Cayce had no income and could not even pay the rent on his home. He felt discouraged, lost and confused, and considered giving up his psychic work and return to a more normal job as a photographer in order to provide for his family. The readings told him not to give up and instructed him to go on a vision quest. He was directed to go to Arizona and to Nogales, Mexico, and meditate in the mines of natural crystalline azurite. He was joined by a trusted friend, Mitchell Hastings, and the two departed on an extraordinary 7,200-mile journey, a remarkable journey that became known later as Cayce's missing month. It would turn out to be an incredible, extraordinary and life-changing quest, a truly fantastic experience that changed both men's life and allowed such clear vision that life purpose became clearly understood and reinforced with dedicated, recharged priority. After being psychically directed to select particularly translucent, rare crystalline specimens of azurite, Cayce and Hastings washed and cleaned their azurite crystals and placed them in the sun to dry. What happened next could easily be described as the fantastic stuff of science fiction. They had remarkable lucid visions of what Cayce and Hastings described as tangible mirages, lucid visions in which dreamlike images of people would appear before them and angelic figures would approach them to impart information, messages and advice over a period of several days. In Mitchell Hastings' case, he encountered a red-haired beauty who presented herself to him in vision, then vanished, and would later appear in flesh and blood when he returned home to New York. She would later become his lifelong partner and wife. Perhaps the most astonishing and revealing of these extraordinary visions was one they had in an azurite minefield in Mexico. An apparition of Edgar Cayce's deceased mother actually materialized in 3D. She appeared and spoke to Edgar about the future. She urged him not to give up hope and not to worry about his precarious financial situation or doubt the power and veracity of the information coming through him. She encouraged him to follow his remarkable service as a provider and channel source of what would be, and is, a truly remarkable body of work. In previous visionary experiences, Edgar had only seen or heard spirit visitors. But in Mexico, perhaps aided by the increased vibration of the azurite all around them, Edgar reportedly received a more tangible manifestation of the visit. In this amazing case, his mother fully physically materialized, not as a wispy light vision, but in full 3D materiality. She walked with him, and sat beside him, and spoke. And then before departing, his mother handed him a brilliant silver coin. And when she had faded from sight, the coin remained in the palm of his hand. He kept it for the remainder of his life. The incredible visions were attributed to the lapis linguis, to the crystalline azurite, providing the vibrational frequency allowing the enhanced visioning effect, as confirmed in the following reading from Edgar Cayce. Cayce reading, quote, "And so it has been given that the lapis linguis is the name which was applied to the special touchstones as those used by the mystically initiated in their various ceremonial activities. Hence the lapis stones facilitated and acquired power through thought projections about them, those then that are of a psychic turn, of strong psychic ability, may hear the emanations, as retained, and as projected by the azurite, emanated by influence. About such azurite stones, in that of the visioning," unquote. Reading 440-11. Reading 691-1, Edgar Cayce, quote, "For the entity should always wear about the body the lapis lazuli, or the lapis linguis. For these will bring strength to the body, through the vibrations that are built in the innate experience of the entity from its mystical sojourn in Egypt, and will awaken the psychic ability in the visioning, unquote. Now, stay tuned for James Tiberon's presentation on the forgotten science of gemstones with focus on azurite. All copyrights duly reserved to www.earthkeeper.com, 2016. Thank you and enjoy. Namaste.
To talk to you about now is the science, this forgotten wisdom about gemstones, about crystals, that their true value is that they are energy generators. In science and in the technical industry, vibrational and sound energies utilize various forms of crystalline minerals to convert vibration and sound into an electrical field. Crystals are remarkably and extraordinarily capable of converting energies into other types of radiation. Crystals are converters. Each form of crystalline mineral is capable to varying degrees of performing specific functions of energy conversions, and listen to this, of luminescence, photonic wave, and electromagnetic wave radiations. Marcel Vogel did an incredible amount of work on this. Crystals can take light and convert it into various forms of radiation. They can take sound and convert it into electricity. That is a fact. They can take a vibrational wave from this microphone and run it through to a speaker where it goes back into sound. But sound is not following through these waves. It is being emitted as an electrical wave, not as an audio vibration. So they convert sound into electricity, back into a sound. That's how a crystal transformer converts sound onto a recording. So we're talking about incredible energy aspects here. And so let me blend these two together in a way that I think is logical. Light is energy, a kind of radiation consisting of photons whose individual energy levels correspond to specific wavelengths. On the electromagnetic spectrum, light is arranged by wavelengths along with other forms of energy, including gamma rays, microwaves, and radio waves. White light, or the visible spectrum, is exemplified by the sun. Now, there is another form of light in which all of the waves are in uniformity and harmony, and that is called coherent light. Now, how do we know that gemstones produce energy, produce light, produce sound? How do we know that? Let's look at this. From one of the major British newspapers, Sunday Times, I believe, a few years ago. And it said, twinkling in the sky is a diamond star of 10 billion trillion trillion carats, astronomers have discovered. The cosmic diamond is a chunk of crystallized carbon 4,000 kilometers across, some 50 light years from the Earth in the constellation Centaurus. Now listen to this. It is the compressed heart of an old star that was once bright like our sun, but has since faded and shrunk. The white dwarf is not only radiant, but also rings like a giant gong, undergoing constant pulsations. And by measuring these pulsations, we are able to study and determine the mineralogical content. It rings like a gigantic gong. It is a diamond 4,000 kilometers across, too big to wear as a pendant. But this shows that crystals and gems emit both waves and sounds. So gems, pulse, frequencies, and geocodes. So what Cayce said was a fact. Cayce said that gems are a forgotten science, minerals are a forgotten science, and it's about their atomic and molecular structure. It is how they tie into these particle accelerators that I spoke about earlier. They tune them, they energize them. Why do women live longer than men? Because they wear these energy generators called diamonds. The diamond works with our soul essence that works in the angelic realm, also called the antimatter realm. Diamonds are by far the most powerful gem on earth. There are more electrons packed into a molecule of diamond than any other thing on earth. A diamond slows down light. Light travels at 286,000 miles per second. When it goes into a diamond, it hits the brakes down to 80. Diamonds, I believe, can also speed up light. Why do women live longer than men? They wear diamonds. Powerful energy generators that affect light. Gems. They are tools. And they have far greater attributes than you may imagine. And as we are moving into a crystalline phase, crystalline being determined by a uniformity of vibration, when all of the atoms and molecules of a particular physical material substance are in perfect order, they're crystals. Heat and time made them perfectly ordered. When we become, through pressure, law of cause and effect, perfectly aligned, we become crystals, and we're moving into that energy now. We are moving into Windows 2012, a far greater geometric pattern. Luminescence. How many of you are familiar with the work of Marcel Vogel? Brilliant man, part of the family. A lot of people attribute Dr. Masaru Emoto of Japan as having done this work on structured water. All of Emoto's information came from Marcel Vogel about structured water. He used crystals, five Vogel crystals, to structure water. And so he talks and tells people, and I've actually tried this, but if you take two quartz crystals and put yourself in a completely black room and you rub these together or lightly hit them together, they will spark, they will create light. Crystals have this ability called luminescence, that when mechanical stress is added to them, they create photons. Just like certain insects, lightning bugs, can through a biochemical process create photons. Certain fish into the dark depths of the water have the ability to biochemically create photonic light. Certain minerals are luminescent. The luminescent minerals absolutely add energy to the chakric systems. And Marcel Vogel agrees with that. And there is another process of using these gemstones that ties in with the light. We are, by definition, beings of light. And John asked me earlier, what is the difference between double refractive and single refractive in light? What does it mean? There's only three gemstones that are single refractive, and that means that light goes straight through them without being bent. Every other type of gem is double refractive, meaning it gets bent at 90 degree angles into a negative and positive wave. And what does a negative and positive wave imply in light reflection? Does it not imply duality? And the singular one, non-polarity? Could it be that the Israelites and the Egyptians were onto something when they wore this high priest plate? It's mentioned in the Bible with nine separate stones. Two of those stones are lapis. Lapis lazuli and lapis linguis, or azurite. And they said that they needed this breastplate to communicate with God. Could it be that these opened the particle accelerators in such a way that it activated that pineal gland, that you were able to change this receptor that Graham Hancock talks about as a receiver of consciousness and not the generator of consciousness, and suddenly you can tune into another channel of a higher version, the one that Mesner created in certain lay patients through magnetic waves, in which uneducated farmers and lay people were able to speak in foreign languages and self-diagnose in the same way that Edgar Cayce was. Could it be that certain things influence our ability to reach these realms? This article that you've all seen about Azurite was sent to me by Allison Ray of the ARE, and it was absolutely something I had been looking for. Really, really interesting information. And it allowed me to see the separations in the three types of lapis. Then in 1933, Edgar Cayce was arrested for practicing medicine without a license. He lost his home, he lost his university, he lost his hospital. And he took off on a journey. He was experiencing doubt. He was experiencing a dark night of the soul. And he took a journey that the guides, the channel sources, told him where to go. And they said, go to Bisbee, Arizona, and look for a mineral of eroded copper called azurite. And he went to this place of azurite, and he had prayers, and he had visions, and he had a friend with him. I believe his name was Hastings, someone that Cayce trusted, and was the only other person besides Gladys who was able to lead him into trance. Now, we were talking earlier about how Cayce said the pyramids were made as iron was made to swim. John was telling me a story once, it was either John or Charles Thomas, that when Cayce would go into this trance state, he would follow directions exactly. And Gladys was taking notes one time, and just inadvertently she said, she meant to say stop here, and she said come here, raised her hand up, and his body floated up to where her hand was. Anti-gravity. Stones were floating. We exist in our material and our ethereal in layers. Just as light occurs in spectrums, matter occurs in spectrums. Just as consciousness occurs in brainwave Hertzian levels, so does our ability to go into other dimensions be determined by our ability to change the vibratory rate. John, as I mentioned early this morning, talked about the importance of being able to change your physical vibration through breathing exercises and meditations, because the Egyptians talked about the human would not really be able to get to that other side of that area of pure knowledge without the ability to go to that other place. And I don't mean just pray and be a good person. I mean learn in the physical process of learning how to get to the other side. I did it several ways, but I fasted for 7 years in a row in a major way, in which I made prayer ties, in which I went off into the wilderness with a facilitator, and I went without food and water. First 2.5 years, nothing happened. In the middle of the third one, I suddenly found myself thrust out of my body. I was having a vision. I saw myself sitting on a rock. I had a Native American vision come to me, and when I closed my eyes, he didn't disappear. And the first thought that I had was, my God, I'm finally having a vision. But it was beautiful. It proved to me that there is another world out there. Carlos Castaneda referred to the two worlds as the tonal and the nagual. He said one existed between the lines of agreement of the other one. But I experienced those, and it wasn't easy. But it was an important breakthrough for me, because suddenly, after taking my vacation from my engineering job and leaving during Christmas, because that's the only time people weren't looking for me, my cell phone wasn't ringing off the hook, I went out right before Christmas, around the 15th, and I would stay until the 21st, which was the solstice, because I wanted to have that powerful experience. And the first 2 years, nothing happened. The second year I went to Tecate, Mexico on that Yaqui reservation, and this wind blew dust in my mouth every day. And I thought to myself, what in the world am I doing out here at my age? Sleeping on the ground, nothing's happening. It's almost Christmas, it's cold, it's rocky. And I really felt a great despair. And I almost quit, but I didn't. And I went back the next year, and I went to Shaman's Dome in Red Rock National Forest. And it was cold. This was Arizona, 4,500 foot elevation. I've got a sleeping bag, but no food the whole time. And on the fourth day, I had that experience. I saw what appeared to be a 3D Native American, and I knew his name was Red Feather. I saw Red Feather, and it was real. And he had a mountain lion with him. And I'm the first to tell you that perhaps it was all a lucid dream that had symbolic meaning for me, but it was real. And I learned how to navigate, and I spoke with him, and I got up and I walked with him, and it was powerful. And it was in a different world, because I saw myself sitting on Shaman's Dome back there, and I can't tell you how meaningful that was for me. And it didn't go away when I closed my eyes. I was in that other realm. And I had teachers come to me that night and talk to me about how I could be a better person, and talk to me about the things that I had done that I needed to get past. Talk to me about the way my father had made me feel inadequate and how I needed to get over that. And it was powerful. And on the next day, I flew over that area. Saw myself still sitting on Shaman's Dome. And I saw Yellowbird's car coming. I saw people on Highway 88 right out of Sedona. And I was seeing 3D, but I was in an ethereal body. But learning how to do that was huge. And it was after that that this channeling started coming in. And I tell people that channeling for me has always been a double-edged sword. I'd prefer to be a scientist in many ways and write research papers, because by education I am a scientist. But I have had these experiences. I have had these experiences where I feel out of my body, and I see certain things, and I have an ability to know certain things, but it took work to get there. And so it's an interesting thing, and I find a lot of validation from people like John when he talks about Casey's message, about the Egyptian mysticism message. And I talked a lot to Graham Hancock about his experiences with ayahuasca, because I went to South America after that and I experienced that. And it is not recreational. It is absolutely the hardest thing I ever did in my life. I saw every wrong thing I have ever committed, and it hurt and it seared me, and I had to get rid of it, and I had to explode that energy outside of myself. It was hard, but it was cleansing. And so Cayce had a similar experience when he went to Bisbee. Everything was collapsing around him. He couldn't feed his family, and he was told to go inside this Azurite mine. And then he was told to go to Nogales, Mexico, to experience crystalline azurite, because crystalline azurite interfaces worlds. And when he went there, his mother appeared to him. And she said, don't quit what you're doing. Don't go back to being a photographer. You have a great purpose in your life. And the friend that was with him, Hastings, knew that he would become one of the great developers of FM radio, one of the great scientists. And he saw his wife. In fact, he recognized his wife from the vision that he had in Nogales, Mexico. And Casey's mother gave him a silver dollar. She manifested and gave him a physical silver dollar, which he kept. And according to Sidney Kirkpatrick, the great writer, Hugh Lynn was given that silver dollar, and it was perfect in every way, except it didn't have a mint mark saying where it was minted. And he showed it to the National Treasury, and they almost arrested him for counterfeiting. They said it was perfect in every way, except that they didn't put on the mark to show where it was minted at, and they never gave it back. And I've spoken to Charles Thomas about that. But this is the story. Ken Carey and others who have written about Azurite said it is the forbidden stone of mastery. The forbidden stone of mastery, meaning, if you want to interpret that, and this is my interpretation of it, there are three forms of lapis, what Edgar Cayce calls lapis lazuli, and that is the blue form that has pyrite in it, which he recommended more than any other mineral in this forgotten science. And then there was lapis azurite, which he said was so strong you could case it in glass to weaken it, that you shouldn't wear it every day. And that was it for me. I knew that was azurite. And he says lapis linguis is azurite, but lapis lazuli is the other one. You can wear that one every day. But it is that forbidden stone of mastery that other writers that have investigated said that it was not told to ungraduated initiates that they could work with azurite. Why? Because it would blow them out of their body the way that ayahuasca might do for a person that's not ready, the way that a vision quest might do for a person that's not ready. Because each time that I had to do those experiences in which I left my body, I had to do something that took strength. I had to control my fear. When I went down to Bolivia and went 17,000 feet high on that mountain and I did the ayahuasca, I had to go through what they called the Campo de Medio. I had to go through the field of fear. And I felt like I was walking on the abyss. When I gave in to fear, I would fall into this horrible area where all my fears were manifest. But once you control that, you go into this other area where you're met by a higher part of yourself and you work on improving yourself, but you had to overcome that fear. And then I think the same thing can occur mineralogically as can occur botanically in the way that certain plants can affect your system in opening the pineal. I think that azurite is the ayahuasca of the mineral kingdom. I think that it can vibrate in such a way that opens the pineal and takes you into this other region. I do not think it's meant to be used every day. I think the crystalline form of azurite is exponentially more powerful. Cayce actually said you could encase certain forms of azurite in glass to weaken the vibration. I don't think that's necessary for everybody. But raw azurite is, I believe, one of the most important tools. And I went to Tucson this year after reading that article, really blew me out of the water. And I'm writing an article that I hope will be in the Venture Inward magazine, that I separate the three forms of lapis into what I think they are and what they do. Luminescent gems that actually can produce photons are lazurite, quartz, diamond, amazonite, sodalite, malachite, lapis lazuli. But note here, lazurite, which occurs in sodalite, malachite, lapis lazuli. Edgar Cayce recommended lapis lazuli more than any other mineral. Lapis lazuli is not expensive. And it can be worn 24/7. Malachite and lapis lazuli both contain copper. Sodalite does not. Lapis lazuli contains pyrite. Pyrite is a very special metal. How many of you ever seen crystallized pyrite? Forms perfect cubes. I suggest to you that the molecular mineralogy that is in the structure of all crystals and metals that are crystalline lines up to the chakra systems. Remember we talked about the platonic solids? Pyrite is a perfect cube, a perfect hexahedron. This is a science. This is a forgotten science that we need to understand as we're going into that new reception of our multi-dimensional selves. Now I want to show you this reference to lapis. The lapis lazuli contains lazurite, calcite, and pyrite. Lapis linguis is lazurite, calcite, and pyrite. What is pyrite? Cubic fool's gold. Very, very powerful. Lapis linguis then is azurite, lazurite, copper. Lapis ligurius is malachite, also eroded crystal green copper. Similar attributes as sodalite and chrysocolla. This is what I believe is the ayahuasca of the mineral kingdom. It opens that pulse. It should not be worn all the time. In 1934, Edgar Cayce was arrested in New York. He made a 7,150-mile southwest field trip that took him to Arizona and then to a copper mine in Nogales, Mexico. And what happened along the way was not only relevant to students of the Cayce work, but also to the FBI, the Federal Treasury, and New York's National Museum of History. Edgar Cayce had gone in search of talking stones. Talking stones, and I'm going to end on this. Most specifically, they were prospecting for lapis linguis or azurite, a dark blue mineral that occurs in either crystals or dull mushroom-shaped domes. According to the spiritual readings that Hastings had received earlier in Virginia Beach, a psychically attuned person could hold azurite in his or her hands for 5 or 10 minutes or wear it against the skin in the form of a pendant and raise their psychic vibrations to such an extent that miraculous visions could happen. Out-of-body experiences could occur. And this is from Cayce Reading 440-11. Lapis linguis can be activated by sunlight, touch, and focal thought. From the Cayce Readings, for the entity should always wear about the body the lapis lazuli or the lapis linguis. For these will bring strength to the body through the vibrations that are built in the innate experience. It has been given that the lapis linguis is the name which was applied to the touchstones or those initiates in various ceremonial activities in the past, referring to Egypt and Atlantis. Hence the stones acquired power through thought projections about them. Those that are of a psychic ability may hear the emanations as retained or thrown off by the influence of such stones. He is saying that lapis linguis or azurite opens audio abilities of channeling. They talk to you. He calls them singing stones. He also says azurite is activated by sunlight. Is activated by sunlight and increases the energy. He also says in some experiences that chrysocolla and copper turquoise and azurite, when you put water on them, they absolutely sing to you and give you messages. I'm telling you that the mineral kingdom is alive. Just as the animal kingdom is alive and the plant kingdom is alive, the mineral kingdom is alive. And you have the ability to interact with the mineral kingdom in ways that no other kingdom can work with you. And that azurite was the stone of the master. It was the stone that allowed you to leave your body and operate in that lucid field at the feet of your higher self and receive instructions from the higher part of you. The part that Edgar Cayce experienced in Nogales, Mexico. It is a powerful, powerful stone. It cannot be worn 24/7, but it can be used in ceremony. Thank you all very much. I'd like to share with you that Ann and I will be leading a pilgrimage in 2016 to what I consider to be one of the most beautiful places in the world, one of the most beautiful places in North America, and that is Banff, Canada. Often tell people from Canada, without intending to be patronizing, that when I go to Canada, I can absolutely feel the higher vibration. And the reason, though, is that Canadians have an incredible benefit of what is called the Canadian Shield. The Canadians live on a giant crystal of metamorphic rock that is 2.5 billion years old. And it absolutely acts as an energizer and a stabilizer. And it covers the eastern two-thirds of Canada. And then in the west, the Canadians have the benefit in Alberta and British Columbia of a powerful columnar of the Rocky Mountains between the 45th and 55th latitudes. Absolutely stunning energy. Western Canada in Banff. Western Canada has some incredible lakes called Lake Louise, Spirit Lake, Peyto Lake. These are turquoise blue lakes, but they are non-Newtonian fluids. Water is a Newtonian fluid. What you have in Canada is water that has a permanently suspended particulate, like milk. And this makes it a non-Newtonian plastic fluid in the scientific terms. Now, these incredible waters in Banff, Canada, in British Columbia, have a permanently suspended particulate they call glacier silt from the ice movement that ground up that rock. And that particulate is silicate, the base component of quartz. And so when you go, you see these incredible waters that have that absolutely iridescent turquoise blue as though it has a light from the inside shining out. How many have been to Lake Louise in the summertime? Unbelievable. Unbelievable. That water has an energy field because it is a liquid crystal. It is a plastic fluid with quartz, with silicate suspended in it. And that color is absolutely breathtaking. The first time I walked around the corner at Lake Louise and saw that, I thought, my God, this is a living postcard. And then you go to places like Lake O'Hara, which is a non-commercialized Lake Louise. And then you go to Yoho National Park near Emerald Lake, and it is just stunning. These places are an anchor of Archangel Michael, that nurturing energy. Incredible, incredible places. So Ann and I are organizing a tour. I've been to that part of Canada. I lived there for a while, actually before I moved to Brazil, before I had met Ann. I loved it. We are organizing an 8-day tour that we are tailor fashioning to places that we know that are very, very special. And we're gonna have time in those. So within the next few weeks, we'll put out the information on that. And there will be limited attendance because really the time to go, it's beautiful year round, but the real time to go is in the peak of the summer. But you have issues when you go to Western Canada. They have this incredible rodeo called the Calgary Stampede. And if you're a rodeo person, it's one of the best. And it occupies every hotel. And it's just not the best time to go if you want to get hotels. So we are probably going to push it to after the stampede and make it in early September. The problem with going in early June is that sometimes Lake Louise is still frozen. I've been to Lake Louise 100 times and I love it. And I went there one time in May and the lake was still frozen. They still had horse sleds going out over it. And I thought, the spring was starting to come. This is like the 20th of May. And I thought, well, I'll walk out there. Well, I got out to the middle and my foot went down into the water about 2 feet. And I thought, oh my God, American lost at Lake Louise. Sank 300 feet to the bottom. And that is a deep lake. I backtracked and I made a promise to myself never to walk on an icy lake again. The point being, Lake Louise is still sometimes frozen over in mid-June. And so we're going to try to find that window. I promise you this will be one of the most picturesque experiences of your life. And nature is alive up there. I mean, it's like Ireland and like Scotland in the sense that you can just feel those Devic energies there. They're just incredible. And a beautiful place. So we'll be releasing details on that. Thank you.